Hear now God's word, Isaiah 53, 3 through 6. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hid their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Please stand as we sing together.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself, he carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer. Rescue for sinners, a ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the blood, the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, yeah. Love so sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Glory to you, God. Messiah. Name above all names. Blessed Redeemer. Man. Rescue for sinners, ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
May be seated. We are thankful to have you here this morning as we seek to bring honor and glory to our God, to thank King Jesus for all that he has done for us. We hope to feel the weight of what Jesus has done and to allow that to impact our hearts so that everything else about us is changed. Today is difficult because we remember what Jesus went through. It's personal because he went through this for you if you believe in him. The price that was paid that we will sing about and read about is the price we deserve. And so we come with heavy hearts. And yet, as those who experience this kind of love, with peace and a joy that supersedes all other experiences and a passion to live in light of what he has done for us. So our longing for you today as you have joined us is not only to experience a service that we seek to honor Jesus in, but to have your heart so draw near to the greatness and glory of this event that we celebrate, that you will leave changed, deeper in your devotion to him, understanding of what he has done in the power of the Spirit, and then longing to live in light of the death of King Jesus. Please bow your heads and hearts with me as we seek to bring honor to him in prayer. Heavenly Father, today we have gathered to remember and to bring honor and glory to you and to your Son, in the power of the Holy Spirit. We realize without you, the depth of what happened will disappear, and we will worship you on the surface and miss the richness of your love, the joy of freedom, of forgiveness, and the purpose of a life lived on mission for you to share the greatness of this event with others. Thank you that Sunday is coming. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that death could not hold you. And yet, as we remember, in the fullness of your Spirit, would you free us from distractions, fixate us on you, and allow us to experience your love in a fresh, deep, and delightful way. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, and for his sake, amen. At the end of our service today, we are going to participate together in communion. We would love for you, in unity with Jesus and with us, to join us in that reflection, remembrance of what Jesus did for us. If you don't have those elements yet, we would like you to have picked them up already. We will ask the ushers, if you just wave your hand as we sing this next song, they will make sure you get some communion elements so that when we participate together, you can join us in that experience of the love of Jesus, in that refocusing and unity that we have as a congregation and remembering. So I encourage you, if you don't have the elements, to wave your hand. Ushers will notice you. And we hope, again, that today is special because we remember the greatest event in the history of the world.
Mm-hmm. step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so high.
You are worthy.
His precious blood purchased man for God. And we crown you, we fall face down and we worship, we all cry out, you are worthy, God, you are worthy, God. Yes, we crown you, we fall face down and we worship, we all cry out, you are worthy. All the shame of the cross, to the Lamb who was slain as atonement for us, to the Son who overcame all the power of death, we praise. For the stripes, for the wounds, for the beating you bore, for the tears, for the blood that was willingly poured, for the merciful one.
Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?"
But he gave no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had a notorious prisoner then called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
"Whom do you want me to release to you today, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Christ?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was at the judgment seat, his wife sent word, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them,
whom, which of these two do you want me to release to you today?
And they said,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
then what shall I do with Jesus, the Christ?
They all said,
let him be crucified.
And he said,
why? What evil has he done?
But they shouted all the more,
let him be crucified.
Thank you.
And they went out, and they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. And they compelled this man to carry his cross. And they came to a place called Golgotha, which means a place of a skull. They offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. And when he had drank it, he tasted it, and he did not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. They then sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head, they put a charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right, one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying,
"You, who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross."
So also the chief priests and the scribes with the elders mocked him, saying,
"He saved others, yet he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'"
And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said,
"This man is calling for Elijah."
And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit.
His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone.
And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth shook, and the rocks were split. When the centurion and those who were with him, keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe, and they said,
"Truly,
this was the Son of God."
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh,
You may be seated. As we have heard the story read, the darkness of our own hearts and our own sin, and the reason that Jesus was on the cross, cry out, it's not fair. It's not fair that the only one who never sinned would have to die in this way. It's not fair that the only one who never said anything wrong was mocked and belittled. It's not fair that his followers had to watch as he was crucified. We use those words quite often to describe things in our own life, some frivolous and some that matter. And I think the words of children often echo in the minds of their parents and grandparents and all, it's not fair. But we often mean things that are on the surface. I remember traveling with one of our elders to a spiritual event. We are going to visit a church to help us to be better elders and a better congregation. And as we were driving, I won't tell you who was driving, but he was sitting next to the one who was behind the steering wheel, the elder that was with me. We saw flashing lights behind us. I noticed immediately as the driver that many had sped by me earlier, and yet I was the one being pulled over. And because it was in the States, we were driving to Seattle, it's not fair that my fine was in American dollars. It's not fair that those who sped by me didn't get pulled over, and it's not fair that the elder next to me remembers this story differently. Maybe your cry of it's not fair is much more substantial than a $100 fine and the humiliation of that elder sharing with all the elders the story. Maybe you've lost a loved one or have been betrayed in a marriage or have children that aren't following Jesus or can't have children at all. We live in a broken world where that cry of it's not fair echoes, it seems, in all of our hearts. And yet, if we understand the depth of the reality of what it truly means to say these words about Jesus, then all of those surface things will go away. And yes, I mean by that the depth of the cry of whatever you've been through when you've said it's not fair. Because in reality, if we understand what Jesus did for us, then all of us deserve what he got. And in fact, because he's the eternal Son of God, we could never experience what he received in that short period of time. We would receive it for all eternity in hell. In fact, it's what Jesus received for us. We often talk about the cross and the physical torment of what it was, and I think there's some benefit to that, to understand what it would have meant to be whipped and mocked and shamed and then crucified, the most excruciating pain. They even came up with that word to describe it, that any human could go through, developed by the Phoenicians, perfected by the Romans, and set up to bring shame and horror to all who watched and to elicit incredible pain from the one being crucified. They did it not only to inflict the pain, but to create fear in those who might do the same crimes. And yet, what was the crime of the one in the middle? For there were three that day, as you have seen and heard read, two that mocked and one that was perfect. His crime is our crime. He who knew no sin became sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. From the story we have heard read, I would like us to see the response of people to Jesus and really focus in on those who are being crucified, because I want to hear from them perhaps what we hear in our own hearts. They both started by rejecting Jesus, both mocked him. It would have been difficult to mock. They would have had to lean up on the nails that were in their feet and hands and pull up the nails touching their nerves, we think, if they did the crucifixion right. But they made fun of Jesus. They joined in with those around Jesus. They were being crucified in humiliation. That mockery would have reached the very gates of heaven, and They were mocking the very one who had just said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Really, the theme of the Holy Week, this bringing of forgiveness to those who don't understand the depth of their own sin. And that certainly was the case even with those being crucified. They're called robbers, in another place, thieves. They're called criminals in some translations. Probably they were murderers. They were deserved of what they got, and yet they mocked the one who had nothing in his debt, if you mean by that sin. It's surprising, I suppose, that at some moment in that interaction of watching Jesus, of seeing those around him, that one of those who was rightly being crucified said, wait a minute. We deserve what we're getting, but he does not. And it's interesting as you study scholars to see how they respond to that. Did he mean the crucifixion, or did he mean the wrath of God being poured out on the Son of God for the glory of God? How much did he understand the weight of his words? I don't know, but we can understand them now. It is horrifying when we realize that the wages of sin is death, that sin is counted in light of the holiness of who God is and his justice, that we deserve worse than anything we have ever experienced. Let the weight of that sink in. That means any time you have cried out, "It's not fair," whether you've been speeding or hiking or broken in the mess of a fallen world, if the Bible is right, and it is, and the pointing of what Jesus has done for us is glorious and weighty, and it is, then anything you've experienced is better than what you deserve. The one robber, murderer, thief, criminal on the cross understood that and was what I have entitled moved by this reality. There was a mockery, and then there was this heart exchange saying, I realize who you are, Jesus. We don't know the depth of what he understood about Jesus, but we know that it was enough. And he placed his faith in Jesus and said to Jesus, "Remember me." And I would say, if I was one in the crowd who was watching him being crucified, maybe a victim of his crimes, maybe he had stolen from me or hurt someone I loved or murdered someone in my family, I don't know, but I would have cried out on that day, "It's not fair," when I heard the words of Jesus. It's not fair. Grace is never fair. And so my hope for this Good Friday, in this time of reflection and singing, of remembering what Jesus did for us and of fixating our eyes on this story, is not that we would stop saying it's not fair, but that we would radically shift what we mean. It's not fair. Praise God for that. It's grace. For this grace is what Jesus offers on the cross. This grace is what Jesus came to bring and to offer and to give. This grace means that you and I, who deserve death because of our sin, receive instead, when we have faith in him, forgiveness, reconciliation, and eternal life. I hope that you feel the heaviness of this day. For this is the greatest day in history when we tie it to the resurrection. And this is the day when we cry out to God, "Thank you that you're not fair. Thank you, Jesus, for coming, for living a perfect life, for dying on the cross. Thank you, Jesus, for paying my penalty in my place for my sin on the cross." You see, the Bible teaches very clearly, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness for sin. And so we're left, as we reflect on this terrible and terrific day, with a choice. We can reject what Jesus did. we can reflect on our own perspective of life and cry out, it's not fair, meaning, God, I deserve so much more. Or we can be moved by the reality of the crucifixion. And we can cry out with tears, mingled with joy, it's not fair, Lord Jesus. For I deserve to pay the penalty for my own sin. And when you cried out on that cross, it is finished, what you meant was Rob's sin, the sins of every person who has ever lived, every sin that has ever been committed, when you declared it is finished, sufficient to pay for all, efficient for those who will believe, those who are part of the eternal call of God. So I hope and pray as you've joined us this morning for this moment of reflection, that as you leave quietly, maybe with tears, that in your reflection, your heart will rejoice in the unfairness of God. Or I suppose, how we usually say this, that your heart will sing in the midst of the tears of His amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved wretches like us. It breaks my heart that we so often forget, and that we live as though this doesn't matter. We live as though what we're going through is only on the surface, and we lose sight of the depth of the reality of the love of God that nothing can separate us from. So my hope, as you've taken the time this morning to come and to join us and to sing, to reflect, and to remember, is that this experience would be much richer than just 1 hour of a precious Friday, but that it would shape your lives. That in this reflection, in this remembering, your mouth would never mock or deflect or with great expectations on the broken world around you or on the God of the culture cry out, it's not fair, but rather in this reflection, the grace of God would overwhelm you. The love of God would compel you, and you'd experience it so richly that you'd know you're never alone. That in the experience of the depth of your pain, His presence would bring you peace, and in the midst of a life that without this is meaningless, you would find purpose and share with others the greatness of the unfairness of God. We want to remember that together even more so by participating in a time of the Lord's table. You see before you this, you have gotten the elements and prepared your hearts. Really, this is a chance for us to declare to God, it's not fair. And we remember that, and because of that, we worship you in awe. We confess our sins and align our lives with you, and we recommit to live our lives to the praise of your glorious grace. If you know Jesus and you're here with us this morning, we want you to worship in this way with us. We want you to experience His love through this celebration and the unity that it brings to us of this fixation with Jesus and what He's done. And so we would like you to take a moment now. I'll close that in prayer from the table, but we'd like you to take a moment now and prepare your heart to cry out to God, it's not fair, in worship and delight because you've experienced His grace, and then to confess any known sin. And then if you know Him and are willing to have that confession in the cleansing of what Jesus has done and paying the penalty in full, that you would participate with us. And in the midst of the heaviness of this day and the sorrow that we experience because we know what our sins have meant to God and what God did in response to them, that sorrow would be mingled with joy, and we together in remembering would honor our Savior. Please bow your heads, bow your hearts, and prepare to continue to remember through through the celebration of communion as you reflect, repent, and renew your first love devotion to Him. Lord Jesus, you know each of us that is here today, and you love us. Thank you for the opportunity that this calendar allows us to have to reflect with more intensity on what you, Lord Jesus, have done for us. In this reflection, we worship. We celebrate your grace. We ask for forgiveness when we live in this frail world without rejoicing in the richness of your death and resurrection. Would you cleanse us from sin, give us a distaste for anything that dishonors your name, and cause us to experience the depth and richness of your love and grace so that we leave this place filled with the fullness of God, heavy and yet rejoicing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. The Bible says, and if you would get out your bread, or what represents that bread, the Bible says, "For what I received from the Lord, that I also deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Please bow your heads and join me in a moment of prayer, and then we will partake together. Lord Jesus, you lived a perfect life. Your life is ours. You paid a penalty that we deserve so that we can have the experience of life in you. As we participate, would you deepen our appreciation of your grace, our delight in your love, and our devotion to live our lives for you and with you? And we thank you. We remember together, and we long to live in light of what you have done for us. We remember. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible says, "In the same way he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns." Please bow your heads and hearts with me again as we remember. Lord Jesus, in our participation, we proclaim your death and anticipate your return. We remember and know, in light of our own sin, that apart from your death and our faith in you, there is no hope for us. And so as we reflect on this precious day, the delight and weight of your glory and the importance of living in light of who you are, of remembering what you have done, we praise you. We declare, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And in Jesus Christ, there is forgiveness of sins. And we rejoice. And we declare we desperately need you and this, and we want to live in light of it. Together in unity, we remember and offer you our lives again. In Jesus' name, amen. It is precious to remember Jesus in this way with you today. Thank you for taking the time to think and to feel and in the power of the Holy Spirit to be changed. After that first precious communion, the Bible says they sang a hymn and then went out. We want to sing together as well, again in reflection and anticipation of Easter that is coming, Resurrection Sunday that is just around the corner, but also in the intensity of His love, the intimacy of what He has done for us, and the incredible price that He paid that we might belong to Him, bought with a price, redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. So would you please join us in singing with joy mingled with terror, delight and desperation met at the cross. His grace is sufficient for me.
Stand with us, please.
Amen. Please bow your heads for our Lord's benediction. Encourage you to, in the reverence of this moment and service, as we anticipate Resurrection Sunday, to exit quietly and reflectively as we continue our boasting and focus in the cross and the worthiness of our God. Here is our Lord's benediction for this precious Friday. Far be it from us to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to us and us to the world. Amen. Go with God.
Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us. To